The Senate will come to order. I ask everyone present to please rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the absence of clergy, let us bow our heads in a moment of silent reflection or prayer. Reading of the journal.
In Senate, Tuesday, February 11th, 2020, the Senate met pursuant to adjournment. The journal of Monday, February 10th, 2020, was read and approved. On motion, Senate adjourned.
Without objection, the journal stands approved as read. Presentation of petitions. Messages from the Assembly. The Secretary will read.
Senator Jackson moves to discharge from the Committee on Housing, Construction, and Community Development Assembly Bill 2625 and substitute it for the identical Senate Bill 3320. Third reading, 390.
Substitution so ordered. Messages from the Governor, reports of standing committees, reports of select committees, communications and reports from state officers, motions and resolutions. Senator Janaris.
Mr. President, at this time, can we please take up previously adopted Resolution 2719 by Senator Harkin, have that read in its entirety, and recognize Senator Harkin.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution Number 2719 by Senator Harkin, congratulating the Pleasantville girls soccer team upon the occasion of capturing the New York State Public High School Athletic Association Class B Championship. Whereas individual and team championships are highly sought after in high school sports, this legislative body commends rare athletic achievements and pays special recognition to those who pursue such excellence and become examples for the youth of this great Empire State. And whereas excellence and success in competitive sports can be achieved only through strenuous practice, team play, and team spirit, nurtured by dedicated coaching and strategic planning. And whereas this legislative body is justly proud to congratulate the Pleasantville girls soccer team upon the occasion of capturing the New York State Public High School Athletic Association Class B Championship on Sunday, November 17th, 2019 in Cortland, New York. And whereas to the praise and applause of their excited fans, the Panthers were able to surmount their opponents in the New York State Championship game and accomplish the utmost high school sporting accomplishment in this great Empire State. And whereas the Pleasantville Panthers ended a very successful season, finishing with an overall record of 21-2 and captured their historic season with a 3-2 victory over Section 3 champion Central Valley Academy to secure the program's first Class B New York State Girls Soccer Championship. And whereas in a sport such as soccer, which demands athletic prowess, speed and agility, and mental toughness, head coach Chris Osterhout and his expert coaching staff worked hard to hone the skills of this championship team, teaching these outstanding athletes lessons which will prove invaluable both on and off the pitch. And whereas Coach Osterhout and all of the outstanding athletes on this Pleasantville High School girls soccer team have clearly utilized dedication, determination, and teamwork in providing a lasting contribution to the spirit of excellence which is a tradition of their school. Now, therefore, be it resolved that this legislative body pause in its deliberations to congratulate the members of the Pleasantville High School girls soccer team, Lila Donahue, Eliza Murphy, Allison Portera, Katrina Kelly, Riley Valvaliza, Mary Grace O'Neill, Lauren Matthews, Grace Capco, Ella O'Malley, Maddie Braverman, Maya Soutoff, Julia O'Reilly, Amber Nanaj, Maeve Rooney, Avery Manna, Isabel Kapoor, Elsa Amirati, Annalise Picard, Izzy Pajovovich, Katie Moses, Lauren Drillick, Lexi Ripstein, Carolyn Lee, Summer DeLuca, Nora Foley, and head coach Chris upon their outstanding season and overall team record of 21-2. And therefore be it further resolved that copies of this resolution suitably engrossed be transmitted to the members of the Pleasantville High School girls soccer team and head coach Chris Osterhout.
Senator Harkin on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. With this resolution, we pay tribute and congratulations to the Pleasantville High School Panthers women's soccer team. And I call them the women's soccer team. I don't like that moniker, girls soccer team. These are fine young women, and we refer to them as the women's soccer team. Thank you, Madam Secretary, for reading the names of the members on the team and the coaches. The principal, Joe Palumbo, is here as well. And would like to also note a noted alumni of Pleasantville High School, our own Eric Katz on our council team. I had a coach when I played soccer who used to say, when you hustle, good things happen. And in the case with the Panthers, nothing more could be true. This was a team that was down by two with 20 minutes left to go in the game. And being down by two, for those of you who know soccer, is almost insurmountable. And yet with 4 seconds left, the game-winning goal was notched because of hustle and grit and determination. So it was a fabulous season that these young women had based on their hard work, their dedication to each other, buying into the system. But it took something extra in those last 20 minutes. And that's what makes champions, is what's inside to give that little extra when nobody else thinks you can. So I congratulate the Pleasantville Panthers. And Mr. President, I ask that you extend them the privileges of the chamber.
To the Pleasantville High School women soccer team, I welcome you on behalf of the Senate. We extend to you all of the courtesies and privileges of this House. Please stand and be recognized. The resolution was previously adopted on February 4th. Senator Janaris.
At this time, Mr. President, can you recognize Senator Kennedy for an introduction?
Senator Kennedy for an introduction.
Thank you, very much, Mr. President. I just want to take this opportunity. It's a great privilege of mine to introduce all the way from Western New York, our great county executive, Mark Polenkars, who has joined us here today. Our county executive just re-elected to a third term, only the second individual ever to be elected to a third term as county executive, is doing a tremendous job, is here working on behalf of the people of Erie County. He's joined by his deputy budget director and former Senate staffer, Ben Swanekamp. Thank you very much for joining here today as well. County Executive Polenkars has led the charge as it pertains to economic development efforts to ensure that we have a clean environment, focus on creating jobs and our greater economy in Western New York, and at the same time ensuring, and this is important to all of us on both sides of the aisle and everywhere across the state, that the only New York State football team, the Buffalo Bills, stays right here in New York State and in Buffalo. He is really on the cutting edge of the issues that are important to people, and he has dedicated his life to public service and, most importantly, helping people, oftentimes the most vulnerable. We thank you, County Executive. We welcome you and your team here today. Thank you for everything that you do on behalf of the great people of Erie County, Western New York, and all of the great state of New York. Please join me in welcoming our County Executive, and Mr. President, if you could offer all of the privileges of the House to our guests. Thank you.
To our Erie County Executive, I welcome you on behalf of the Senate. We extend to you all of the courtesies and privileges of this House. We want to recognize you at this time. Thank you. Senator Janaris.
Can we now take up previously adopted resolution 2773 by Senator Little? Read its title only and recognize Senator Little.
The Secretary will read.
Senate Resolution 2773 by Senator Little, legislative resolution commemorating the 40th anniversary of the 1980 Lake Placid Winter Olympics and celebrating its legacy, past, present, and future.
Senator Little, on the resolution.
Thank you, Mr. President. While I acknowledge that there are many here today that were not even born in 1980, many of us do remember the last time that Lake Placid and New York hosted the World Olympic Winter Games. Lake Placid first hosted the Olympic Games in 1932 and then again in 1980. They are one of very few locations that has held two Olympic Games. So, in order to celebrate, we have a big parade going on beginning on February 13th, which is the exact same days that the Olympics were held back then, February 13th to the 23rd. If you recall, those of you who remember, there was a shortage of snow that winter, and they were trucking snow from every place they could to bring it into the venues. But at any rate, so doing it the same way, the games begin on the 13th, but on the 14th we have a parade with many of the volunteers. Lake Placid is a village of volunteers who had volunteered in 1980 and continue to volunteer at the events that take place then. And then we will go to the original site of where the torch was lit. And we will light the torch again in recognition and celebration of 40 years and still having all of the Olympic venues. Many cities that have had the Olympics, you know, put a lot of money into their venues and then they become historic. We are not doing that here in New York State. We're very proud of Lake Placid having had the Olympics. This year's budget has millions of dollars in it to help keep the venues, the ski jumps, the bobsled, the luge, the cross-country skis, the downhill skiing area, the ice skating rinks, the ice oval, all of these things, so that we're not historic, we are relevant. We will continue to hold World Cup games, and we are going to host in 2023 the World Universiad Games, where 2,600 athletes will come from around the world and compete over the course of 12 days. But back to our celebration, which starts Friday, Thursday and Friday. I'll be there, and the temperature is only supposed to be minus 16, so we will see how that goes. We need to warm it up. But we're also going to have many Olympians return to the area. Some of them are from our area, but Andrew Weibrecht, Thomas Vaughn, Dan Jensen, the figure skaters Scott Hamilton and Paul Wiley, who now lives in Lake Placid, will also be there. So the point of the whole thing is just to have all of you help celebrate this and remember that we are very fortunate in New York. And if you watch any winter competition on television, you will hear Lake Placid being named, because all of these athletes that compete on a worldwide stage have competed in Lake Placid. And that helps us, that helps New York, it helps our tourism, and it attracts more people to the area. So without further ado, I would invite you to get to Lake Placid, if you can't in the next 2 weeks at some point, and enjoy what we call the winter sports capital of the world. Thank you, Mr. President.
The resolution was previously adopted on February 11th. Senator Gennaris.
Sponsors, the two resolutions we took up today are open for co-sponsorship.
The resolutions are open for co-sponsorship. Should you choose not to be a co-sponsor of the resolutions, please notify the desk. Senator Gennaris.
Please take up the reading of the calendar.
The Secretary will read.
Calendar 387, Senate Print 1714 by Senator Brooks, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Adabel Flanagan, Gianaris, Kruger, Stewart Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
Ayes 55, nays 4.
The bill is passed.
Those senators in the negative are Senator Helming, Senator Jordan, O'Mara, and Ortz. Calendar 388, Senate Print 1726A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the real property actions and proceeding law.
Laid aside.
Calendar 389, Senate Print 2813A by Senator Comrie, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
Ayes 59.
The bill is passed.
Calendar 390 by Assembly Print 2625 by Assemblyman Dinowitz, an act to amend the real property actions and proceedings law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 30th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Flanagan.
Announce the results.
Those recorded in the negative are Senators Zakshar, Amador, Borrello, Flanagan, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Little, Laval, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Robach, Serino, and Tedisco's. Ayes 43, nays 16.
The bill is passed.
Calendar 391. Senate Print 4938 by Senator Carlucci, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 1st of January.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas. Those recorded in the negative on calendar 391 are Senators Zakshar, Amador, Flanagan, Jordan, Laval, O'Mara, Ort, Serino, and Seward. Ayes 50, nays 9.
The bill is passed.
Calendar 392, Senate Print 7287A by Senator Bailey, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 180th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
Those senators recorded in the negative are Senators Zakshar, Amador, Borrello, Boyle, Flanagan, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Lanza, Laval, Little, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Robach, Serino, Seward, and Tedisco. Ayes 40, nays 19.
The bill is passed.
Calendar number 393, Senate Print 7288A by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the executive law.
Laid aside.
Calendar 394, Senate Print 7291A by Senator Prasad, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 120th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
Those senators recorded in the negative on calendar 394 are Senators Akshar, Amador, Borrello, Griffo, Helming, Jordan, Little, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Serino, Seward, Todisco. Ayes 46, nays 13.
The bill is passed.
Calendar 395, Senate Print 7292A by Senator May, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 120th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
In regard to calendars 395, those senators recorded in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Borrello, Boyle, Flanagan, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Lanza, Laval, Little, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Serino, Seward, and Todisco. Ayes 42, nays 17.
The bill is passed.
Calendar 396, Senate Print 7300A by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section. Oh, lay it aside for the day.
Calendar 397, Senate Print 7301 by Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the executive law.
Read the last section.
This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Flanagan. Griffo. Jordan. Helming.
Announce the results.
In regard to calendar number 397, those senators voting in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Flanagan, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, O'Mara, Ritchie, and Serino. Ayes 49, nays 10.
The bill is passed. Senator Giannaris, that completes the reading of today's calendar.
Let us now move on to the reading of the controversial calendar, please.
The secretary will ring the bell. The secretary will read.
Calendar number 388, Senate Print 1726 by Senator Skoufis.
Senator Amador.
Sponsor, yield for a couple questions.
Of course.
Sponsor yields.
Through you, Mr. President. Thank you, Senator Skoufis, for yielding and hopefully answering a few of these questions. As it applies to this bill, what is the definition, vacant and abandoned?
Through you, Mr. President. This bill would affect those properties that are in the foreclosure process. zombie properties, as they're known.
Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue
Does
to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yep.
Sponsor yields.
So under any circumstance, would this bill apply to homes that have been damaged due to natural disasters, fires, floods, storm events, that have been vacated by the owner?
Mr. President, the short answer is no. So, you know, if a tree falls into a home or if there's a hurricane that does damage to a property, plywood will still be a permissible material. This bill only applies to those properties that are in the foreclosure process.
You, Mr. President, the sponsor continues.
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Instead of plywood, wood composites, wood veneers, or similar wood-based products, what would be used to board up the homes?
Through you, Mr. President, the primary alternative would be clear boarding. So just as a little bit of background, in 2017, the state of Ohio actually did what we are proposing to do here in prohibiting plywood from being used to board up foreclosed homes. And additionally, a number of municipalities, including Oyster Bay here in New York State, have enacted similar laws. The primary alternative would be clear boarding, which is a polycarbonate. It's about 250 times as strong as glass. It's very secure. And perhaps most importantly, if you're a home right across the street from a vacant foreclosed property that is employing this polycarbonate clear boarding, you would not even be able to tell that the windows are boarded up. It would seem like a window was there. And so this bill looks to reduce blight. That's what we've seen in Ohio and these other municipalities that have employed a law like this.
Through you, Mr. President, if the sponsor continues.
The sponsor yields.
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
So the sponsor mentioned polycarbonate, which industry standards, sheet goods, be Lexan sheets. That's what I think you're talking and referring to when you say clear view type of product. Basically, in layman's terms, you refer polycarbonate to plastic. So you would much rather have a plastic material be used to board up or to secure an abandoned home than a more rigid material such as a plywood that is very green, by the way. Wood is very green and sustainable. But through you, Mr. President, does the sponsor know what the cost of a sheet of polycarbonate would be?
Mr. President, I think approximately $20 to board up a single window with plywood.
Mr. President, so with plywood, wood product, you're talking about a $20 cost for a sheet good, 4x8 sheet, it would cost. My question was, through you, Mr. President, what would the cost of a 4x8 sheet of carbon or polycarbonate be? And I know it's depending on the thickness, so if you went to maybe a 4 mil or 6 mil, which is equivalent to about 3/8 inch thick or maybe 1/4 inch thick, do you know what the cost would be?
Through you, Mr. President, there's no doubt that certainly using polycarbonate would be more expensive than plywood on the front end. However, I would point out that, for example, the U.S. Fire Administration offers very positive remarks and recommends clear boarding because it cuts down on arson, it cuts down on squatters, lots of problems that wind up costing municipalities down the road on the back end. Furthermore, I'll also point out that a number of years ago, Fannie Mae voluntarily, internally, decided that for any mortgages backed by their organization, that they would require their lending organizations, banks, et cetera, that issued these mortgages to employ clear boarding. And so for many, many, many foreclosures and vacant homes already that have mortgages backed by Fannie Mae, they're already doing this. And so, you know, this is I understand what my colleague is trying to get to, but the point is that home values are dramatically negatively impacted by boarded-up blight all throughout the state. This is an attempt to try and preserve home values and, on the back end, prevent some of the problems that come with squatters, fires, arson, et cetera, that also puts our first responders in more danger.
Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
I understand the intent of the sponsor's bill here that you're trying to protect from blight and making sure that we have safe, abandoned structures or homes so that they will not be vandalized. But through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor answer how would someone know that a home is in foreclosure in the neighborhood?
Through you, Mr. President, pursuant to some zombie property legislation that we enacted a couple of years ago, these zombie properties now have to be registered with the state.
Mr. President, sponsor continue to yield.
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Is there a law that requires the municipality or the bank or the mortgage provider to post a very distinct, colorful poster or notice on the door of the building or home that it is in foreclosure?
Not that staff nor I are aware of.
Through you, Mr. President.
Will the sponsor yield? Yes.
It actually is part of the rule or law that we have, I believe. Look it up, Council can, because that really is and determines and signifies that this home is going through a foreclosure process. Many times it's very bright yellow notice that's affixed to a building, which is more of a target to a vandal or someone who wants maybe a squatter to go into a vacant home than a boarded home that has wood product that is securing the home from the vandals. So I just think that you should understand what that really is with that notice. Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor yield for one more question?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Sponsor yields.
Who would be responsible to install and pay for this plastic screening that you want to put on the windows and doors?
Through you, Mr. President, primarily banks, except in those more rare situations where a municipality owns a building through condemnation or some other means.
Mr. President,
If I may, through you, Mr. President, I also want to note, in response to a number of items that my colleague just had remarked upon, that law enforcement is actually, in many cases where this is employed, very positive towards clearboarding because, look, we're not touching, this law does not touch any posting of flyers on doors. And so, look, if there's an issue with that my colleague has, I would recommend that we revisit the zombie property legislation that he's referring to. This bill does not touch on any notification posting of flyers, as he's suggesting. But I'll also note what he's describing then is actually a remark in support of this legislation. It makes it even more imperative that we have clear boarding, such that when law enforcement is trying to determine whether there are folks, squatters, other individuals that shouldn't be in a vacant building are there, they can't obviously see through plywood. They can see through clearboarding, and that in itself will, we believe, deter squatting, but also provide a means by which law enforcement can determine if there are people in a building that shouldn't be there.
President on the bill.
Senator Amador on the bill.
You know, the sponsor's memo states that properties boarded up with plywood presents themselves as an easy target for vandals. And that's why I brought up the notice issue, because there's absolutely no brainer for someone to go down the road, drive down the road, walk down the sidewalk, whatever it may be, when they see that notice, you want to talk about an easy target to understand that this building or this home is vacant. That's the definition or the significant difference between a home that's vacant and one that is not. It's not the plywood or it's not the plastic that you want to put in the windows. The sponsor also mentioned that it could be, and in some cases it will be, the municipality. I asked if he knew what the cost of polycarbonate, a sheet good of polycarbonate, would be. And I wouldn't expect anyone in this room really to understand, because you typically never buy a sheet of polycarbonate or Lexan on a day-to-day basis. But I got a little bit of industry knowledge to understand and know what building costs are. So I will say he was right when he responded back to about $20, when that cost refers to a plywood, wood-type product. Because you can buy today a sheet of, say, 4x8x1/2 inch thick plywood for about $20. It'll range from about $17 to $30, depending on the grade of plywood. But polycarbonate, depending on the thickness, and the thickness really talks about the rigidity. And when you want to secure a building, you can't tell me that putting on an 1/8 inch thick piece of plastic, or even 1/4 inch thick piece of plastic, is going to secure the building more than 1/2 inch wood or 3/4 inch wood product that they currently do now. The bill also goes on to refer to not just wood products or plywoods, but it also talks about wood composites and wood veneers. Wood composites are products that are very green friendly. They're recyclable products. They're recycled material products. So I just think that this bill, well-intentioned, because we want to make sure all of our neighborhoods are safe, are free from vandalism, fighting the blight problems that we all face in all of our districts, that we have products that we can use that are green and safe and just really just common sense, because they're much stronger and more readily available. Try to go and buy polycarbonate in your local hardware store. You're not going to. You got to order it. But then it's the cost factor. And when we talk about unfunded mandates, and if the municipality has to pay for this cost, the cost of polycarbonate is in well. It's in excess of over $150 a sheet based on the thickness, which really is going to be around an 1/8 inch thick 4x8 sheet of plastic. So if I go from $20 of being wood product base to now the municipality to have to pay about $150 a sheet for an 1/8 inch thick, I think that this is an unfunded mandate that municipalities can't absorb and that will not do the job that I really truly believe that the sponsor's intention is going to do, or what he wants to do, and that is secure the buildings and to help fight blight. So with that, Mr. President, I'll be voting in the negative. Thank you.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
This act shall take effect on the 90th day after it shall have become a law.
Call the roll.
Adabel, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart Cousins, Thomas.
Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 388, those senators recorded in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Borrello, Boyle, Brooks, Flanagan, Funke, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Lanza, Laval, Little, Martinez, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Robach, Serino, Seward, Tedisco. Senator Montgomery is absent from voting. Okay. Ayes. What is that? Ayes 36, nays 22.
The bill is passed. The secretary will read.
Calendar 393, Senate Print 7288A by Senator Kavanaugh, an act to amend the executive law.
Senator Helming.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise to ask if the sponsor will yield for a few questions.
Does the sponsor yield?
Absolutely, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
Through you, Mr. President. This legislation directs the Secretary of State to administer a registry to receive information from three entities, from landlords, local governments, and also code enforcement agencies. Senator Kavanaugh, I was wondering if you could explain for me how code enforcement agencies are defined.
Yeah, let me just begin, just for context, the bill generally would view code enforcement agencies as part of, the code enforcement agencies in the state are generally administered by local governments, and I think there's not an expectation that code enforcement agencies that are not part of our local governments would be complying with this law. So basically, it is the under our current state law, there is a uniform code. That uniform code is applicable all over the state, and localities are required to enforce it unless they take a step to adopt their own code, at which point there's a process by which the Secretary of State can review that code and determine whether it is at least as stringent as the uniform code. In the circumstance where there is a local code or the state code is applicable, each locality is enforcing that code, and those agencies are operating throughout the state.
Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. So through the administration of the uniform building and codes and fire codes, et cetera, is it possible that fire departments and fire districts, both paid and volunteer, could be responsible for the costly reporting requirements, the onerous requirements that are a part of this legislation?
Mr. President, that's quite a leading question, so let me just begin by saying we do not believe there are onerous requirements on any localities or code enforcement agencies in this bill. Secondly, if an agency is not currently required to be enforcing the code, then this bill would not create any obligation on them at all. So I will confess that I have great familiarity with the FDNY and the City Buildings Department and HPD. I'm not sure how fire codes are enforced in every jurisdiction, but my sense is that in general, volunteer fire departments are not enforced, and other such agencies are not currently obligated to enforce building, fire, and housing codes. So they would be unaffected in any way by this bill.
Through you, Mr. President. So, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Section 2 of this legislation defines covered dwelling. Is it possible that this definition could be interpreted to apply to, for instance, bed and breakfast, Airbnb, and even mobile home parks or mobile homes?
Through you, Mr. President, let me actually get the words in front of me, but the bill in general is intended to cover rental. Sorry, I'm having... I was trying to make sure I was looking at the same language you're looking at. So the bill defines a covered dwelling as a dwelling which is either rented, leased, let, or hired out to be occupied, or is occupied as a residence or home of two or more families living independently of each other. So if a dwelling unit is a residence for somebody and it is rented out, or you have, you know, a situation where independent families are living in the same space, it would be covered by this law. And whether, you know, if I presumably calling it an Airbnb or calling it a bed and breakfast does not preclude compliance with the law related to rental housing, the many laws related to rental housing in the state, and I think this would be no different. If it is, but generally speaking, just to be clear, this is intended to be broad. It's intended to cover rental housing, rental residential units anywhere we find them in the state.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
There are a lot of good intentions that pass through this floor in the form of legislation, and we've seen a number of chapter amendments because things are rushed through and don't accurately reflect what we intend them to do or don't do what we intend them to do. So my question is, as we all know, in many areas of our state, we've talked about this here on this floor, residents, municipalities, small businesses, even some libraries in my district do not have internet services. And it's possible that some landlords, and I think you need to think outside of New York City, think upstate New York, rural areas, some landlords, they may have, for instance, it may be a very small family farm who produces enough food, maybe just even feed the family. Maybe they have a roadside stand, but on their property, they have a rental home. But they don't have the desire or maybe even the means to own a computer. And again, they don't even have access, all of them, to internet services. So in these situations, Senator Kavanaugh, what alternatives exist to the online registration that are available for a landlord to register?
And if I may, first let me respond to the first part, the implicit first part of the question, which is about legislation that is sometimes rushed and ill-considered. Just to note that this bill is one of the recommendations that came out of an investigation that we announced along with Senator Skoufis and the Investigations and Government Operations Committee 13 months ago. It was a five-month investigation looking very thoroughly at the code enforcement operations of four localities that were selected as samples of what might be going on in other places. That then led to a hearing in May of last year where we took testimony from many parties, including parties representing small localities and other jurisdictions throughout the state. We then produced a report of about 100 pages that reflects the findings of the investigation and also makes recommendations, including a recommendation that there be statewide rental registry. That report's been available for all of us to review. It's a page turner at about 100 pages. We then, earlier this year, announced an intention to do 11 bills. They are the bills that are before you today. We announced a public hearing on those bills. We held that public hearing. We got testimony on that on these bills from the Real Estate Board of New York, Legal Aid of New York City, Enterprise, the New York Conference of Mayors, the New York State Codes Coalition and the International Codes Committee, and the New York State Building Officials Conference, the Rockland County Illegal Housing Task Force, the New York State Attorney General, Citizen Action, the Community Service Society, the City of Albany, United Tenants of Albany, the Rochester Tenants Union, and the Mayor's Office of New York City. And in addition, we had informal conversations with the state executive branch, as well as the Center for Community Progress and many others. We also had, obviously, a lively discussion in committee a few days ago about this. And I would just say that, you know, this is a very thoroughly considered process. I would also note that subsequent to our hearing, we made several amendments to the bill that are intended to diminish the burden on localities. And I'm happy to discuss those as well. But that was in response to testimony received on this bill. In terms of an individual owner renting an individual apartment as a business and to make some money on the side, if you choose to be a landlord in this state, you are choosing to put yourself in the business of providing housing to somebody else, and that comes with many obligations to protect the safety of the occupant, also, by the way, to protect the safety of first responders who might find themselves coming to that place in an emergency. And there is no alternative to registering, but once a year you would have to get this information to the Secretary of State, which is basically the basic information that you ought to have at your disposal as an owner of a piece of property. There's no obligation that you do it on a computer in your home, and the penalty for not doing so, if you have a single unit, would be $25.
Or no on whether or not there were alternatives to online registration. Also,
Senator, are you asking the sponsor to yield for a question?
Yes.
Will the sponsor yield?
I'm happy to clarify.
Sponsor yields.
There is no obligation, there's no requirement in this bill that the application be submitted online. It is expected that most people in the real estate business would prefer the option of submitting it online, but the Secretary of State under this bill would be required to set up a process that permits people to register online, and certainly it would be within the discretion of the Secretary of State to have somebody receive a mailed piece of paper from this owner of a one-unit rental operation.
President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
So the legislation refers to...
Senator, sorry. Does the sponsor yield? Do you yield? Sponsor yields.
The legislation refers to an online portal. I didn't see anything else about paper or any other alternatives. Also, when we talk about municipalities... Am I on through you, Mr.? Okay. When we talk about... the research that's been done to develop this particular piece of legislation, because that's all we're addressing right now, not all of the bills that have been brought forth today. There were four communities, it's my understanding, that provided testimony. I'd like to just point out that the average population exceeds 50,000. Compare that to areas where I live, where the largest city, the population is about 11,000, and I think it really changes the story. So my question is, this legislation states that the Secretary of State will provide municipalities with technical support. I'd like to understand what that technical support will look like, and will it include assistance with securing consistent, reliable, and affordable broadband services? Again, we're not talking about just New York City, we're talking about the entire state of New York, where some of our municipalities do not have, they have intermittent internet services or no internet services?
Mr. President, if I may I return to the previous subject, because I think council was helpful in understanding what my colleague was referring to. Just to clarify, there is language in the bill that says the data from the registry must be available online. It is the Secretary of State's job to make the data available to people on the line. There's nothing in this bill that requires the Secretary of State to receive the data online. So the Secretary of State could receive the data in any manner that they choose from landlords, and presumably if a small landlord wants to send a single registry by mail or some other purpose, that would be perfectly compliant with this law. Again, I don't want to be argumentative, but I'm perplexed by the repeated assertions that it's important we think about places other than New York City. We had a hearing in Newburgh on this topic, and we had a hearing in Albany on this topic. The Housing Committee and other committees have traveled the state to have hearings. We had a hearing in Greenberg last year and in other parts of the state, and we continue to seek input from all parts of the state. We also had input from, as I mentioned before, the New York Conference of Mayors, which represents some mayors of some quite small jurisdictions, and other organizations, and we reached out to the Association of Towns and the Association of Counties and others to get as much input as we could on this piece of legislation. In terms of the question of how localities will comply, again, I would note that we amended the bill in response to commentary about that. Under the bill as currently written, it is the obligation of the Secretary of State to provide the means by which people will produce this information, and it is also their obligation to assist localities to the extent necessary to comply with this, and particularly to help them have the ability to submit data through in a machine-readable format, electronically. If a locality does not have the capacity to do that, it is not practical for that locality to do that, the landlords in that jurisdiction would still be required to register, but there is no mandate in this bill for localities to do things that they're not capable of doing.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yeah, with pleasure, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Can you explain to me how landlords will be identified and notified about these registration requirements?
Through you, Mr. President, this will take a significant amount of time before this process is up and running. First of all, obviously, the bill would still need to go through the assembly and be signed by the governor, and it doesn't take effect for a full year after that. And the portal, the database that would be required would be available 2 years after the effective date of this law, which again could be many months from now. I think it's landlords and people who choose to be in the business of being a landlord and renting apartments to others presumably have some obligation to keep up with the basic requirements that come with being a landlord. And I mentioned there are many, and many of those are essential to the life and safety of the tenants and of first responders and of others. But we would presumably the Secretary of State and others would have some obligation to notify people of their requirements. Presumably localities would do that. I would also note that there are several localities in the state that already have these kinds of systems in place. Presumably the local authorities would play some role in ensuring, as they do with many requirements that are about code enforcement and life and safety, would play some role in informing people. But, you know, landlords need to stay up abreast on the obligations they have as landlords, and this would be one more modest obligation that once a year they identify their apartment. And again, if they fail to do so or they do not hear about this, the implication of that will be a $25 penalty that would be imposed.
Through you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Okay. The original version of this bill required landlords to register every 3 years. The amended version that we saw that's before us today changes that to annually. Can you explain the reason for this change?
This was, as you know, a change in the, along with a number of changes that were intended to make this registry both easier for localities to comply with and also more useful. And we found that many existing registries have a one-year requirement rather than a free requirement, and that is intended to make the registry more useful for the many purposes for which it's intended, including having localities have some ability to track who currently owns real estate in their rental real estate in their jurisdiction. So we thought that if one of the purposes that we can be sure that local authorities know who to call in the event there's a serious problem, they have a name and address and a phone number, which is part of this requirement, we thought that having that information perhaps be as much as 3 years out of date is not wise, so we decided to make it an annual requirement. And again, for most landlords, the information, if nothing has changed about your property, the information you're registering also won't change in a significant way.
Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Section 5 of the bill states that any local government with a registry may continue to maintain that registry. If the local registry does not comply with the state registry, the landlord must register with the state according to this language. Senator Kavanaugh, under these circumstances, does this mean the landlord must register twice? Once with the local registry and the second time with the state registry?
The extent, through you, Mr. President, to the extent that such registries exist in localities already, we decided that we would not choose to preempt local registration requirements. And so local registries are allowed to continue to have registries. And again, that's that registry may serve a different purpose in the locality than this registry is intended to serve. So what the bill contemplates is a process where the Secretary of State will review an existing registry. If they find that existing registry to have the information necessary to comply with this law, then the bill expressly says that somebody won't have to register twice. However, we didn't want to say as long as there's a registry, irrespective of whatever condition that registry is in, whatever information that registry is in, we didn't want to exempt people from this bill because the goal is to ensure that all rental properties are registered in a manner that this bill contemplates. So if a locality has a registry and they either decline to make it conform to this or they don't make it conform to this for some other reason, then a register, just as now, landlords would have to continue to comply with local law and they would also have to comply with this law. Just to note, it's new, current localities that do have a registry are the City of New York, Buffalo, Syracuse, and East Hampton. There may be others as well. We've had conversations with some of them and they have expressed an expectation that they would comply their register, they would conform their registry with this registry so that the landlords in their jurisdiction wouldn't have to register twice.
For you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
So it is possible then, or according to this legislation, municipality must provide the information back to the Secretary of State in the format that the Secretary of State deems acceptable. So there is the possibility for, again, unfunded mandates on the community and so much more. Section 7B of this legislation talks about a schedule of reasonable registration fees based on the type of dwelling and the number of units registered. Is there a cost to the landlord to register?
Through you, Mr. President, I think there were two questions in there.
There was one question.
Sorry, there was a statement that I might want to respond to. I'll take the first question, the explicit question first. Yes, there is in this bill an expectation that the Secretary of State would charge a fee to register, which is common in registration systems, and that fee would be required by this law to be reasonable, and presumably in this context reasonable, like many fees, this is not a tax, this is a fee, presumably the fee should reflect the cost of providing this service of creating a registry and of having people register. It also requires that there be an online portal through which people can do it. So it is, the expectation would be that the Secretary of State would identify an efficient way to do this and charge a fee. And that fee is not set by this law because I think there are a lot of steps between now and this being implemented that would be necessary to determine the precise cost.
Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
Senator Kavanaugh, can you explain if this registration fee or when this registration fee is assessed, where the money will go? Will it go to the general fund, the state budget, or where will the money go?
Mr. President, through you, I'm not 100% certain whether this bill, I mean, It is clear that the Secretary of State is being authorized to charge a fee. I would note that the Secretary of State charges many, many fees to register for many, many things in the state already. But I will confess I'm not an expert in how much discretion the Secretary of State, which of course is a part of the executive branch, how much discretion that the Secretary of State has over fees that are charged. But I would note that we have many, many statutes that charge fees that don't specify what part of the state budget they go to. And I think this bill is like many, many other statutes in that way.
Through you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
In the case where the landlord is required to register twice, once potentially with the municipality and the second time with the state, is it possible that they'll be assessed a registration fee twice?
And again, my very helpful counsel has noted that absent any language in this bill about where the fee would go, absent any language in this bill about where the fee would go, the fee would likely go to the general fund of the state of New York to offset the costs of the general costs of state government. In terms of the likelihood that a fee is assessed by a locality in addition to this fee, that would be up to the locality. So we are not requiring localities to have a registry. We're not requiring them to assess fees. We're just creating a single statewide standard with a fee associated with it. If localities choose to maintain their own registry for their own reasons, that is an important aspect of our system, that localities can run their governments in the manner that they choose. And so there's nothing in this bill that would require people to be charged twice. And in fact, there are many provisions in this bill that are intended to facilitate there being a single registry. But if a locality decides to continue its registry and continues to charge a fee, there's nothing in this bill that would stop them.
Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
According to the legislation, local governments, at a minimum, must submit reports on a monthly basis, taking into consideration the manpower that is going to require, upgrades to systems to comply with the formatting requirements, and more. Do you have an estimate of the cost to our local counties, our cities, our towns, and our villages?
Through you, Mr. President, the bill requires that this is something that we've changed since a prior draft of the bill. The bill requires that, to the extent practicable, local governments submit that information and that the Secretary of State provide localities, to the extent they have any difficulty doing that, provide localities with assistance in figuring out how to do that. Our assumption is that that will be done digitally, and our assumption that it will be done with a very modest level of physical work by paid employees, because most code enforcement systems at this point are either currently working off digital systems that track violations, because it's very difficult to run a code enforcement operation without such a system, or they're moving in that direction. But again, this bill contemplates that if that is not practicable for the local government, they would not have to do it under this bill.
Do you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Am I to understand then, if a municipality chooses not to comply with this, they will not be penalized in any way, or there's no language in this bill that requires them to provide registry information or to provide code enforcement violations?
Through you, Mr. President, again, there's nothing in this bill that says they may choose freely, irrespective of their capacity not to comply. What the bill says is that they shall submit this information unless it is not practicable for them to do so, given their capacity. And in that case, the Secretary of State is required by this bill to work with them and provide them with assistance in submitting that information in a machine-readable format, digitally. Presumably, there'll be conversations between the Secretary of State and localities about what it would take to submit the information necessary to populate this portal with the relevant data. But again, this is in a previous version of this bill, it required this data to be submitted, and we have in order to respect the complexity of this and the different capacities of local governments, we've modified the bill to say that they are only required to do this to the extent practicable. I will say that one of the beneficiaries of a bill like this will be the localities themselves, because having a database of all rental properties is a very valuable thing if you're a local code enforcement agency or a local government and you're trying to enforce your code. So we expect that many local governments will embrace this, but there's nothing in this bill that requires them to do so if it's not practicable for them to do so.
Through you, Mr. President, will the sponsor continue to yield for one more question?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
Looking at the long list of information that is now going to be required to be reported in this registry, there really is going to be significant information, physical addresses of all the rental properties, total number of rooms, and accessibility features into these properties. I have some concerns about privacy issues. I also have concerns about, in my small communities, when you look at a database and you look at a community that may have, say, 15 rentals maximum, if there is a victim of domestic violence hiding out, residing in one of those rental properties, now the person who has victimized him or her could potentially go to this database if they know the community that they're living in and narrow it down to those 10, 15 rentals and systematically, easily go through each one of them. Now they'll have access to know how to get into these properties, because, like I said, all the accessibility features are required to be reported in this database, et cetera. So, Senator Kavanaugh, I'm wondering if you have any privacy concerns with this legislation or any concerns that this registry would provide a mechanism for domestic abusers to more easily locate their victims who may be living and hiding in a rental property.
Through you, Mr. President, obviously, if there are many people with a great deal more expertise than I have about the needs of people who may be in that terrible situation of having an abuser and somebody they want to be physically separated from, if there were, if any of the many organizations that address that had some concern about that, we certainly would be willing to address that, as we have in other circumstances. For example, we've passed laws in this House about the voter rolls, which are also somewhat public accessible, but to make exceptions there. Having said that, I don't see any provision in this bill that would meaningfully alter that. If you are looking for someone and you know they live in a jurisdiction, you know that they're renting an apartment and you know that they're renting in a jurisdiction with only 15 apartments in it, or a very small jurisdiction, you have various means to try to locate rental apartments in that jurisdiction. This bill doesn't give you any additional information at all about who's living in apartments. The reference to accessibility features is things that would help an apartment comply with the ADA and would help people who are seeking an accessible apartment, something that might be accessible given a physical disability, to rent an apartment. But there's nothing in here that suggests how to get into the building or what the security features of buildings are. None of that would be included in the registry as contemplated by this bill.
Bill, Mr. President.
Senator Helming on the bill.
First, I'd like to thank Senator Kavanaugh for all of his time and answering all of my questions. I appreciate it. Thank you. When I consider how to vote on the legislation, I look at the legislation and I evaluate a number of factors. Some of those factors include, is it an unfunded mandate? Is it yet another burden that we're placing on our small cities, our towns, our villages, and our counties? The answer here is an emphatic, absolutely yes. This is an unfunded mandate. When I did my summer of small business tours and I talked to so many business owners from not only in my district but from across the state in New York, one of their concerns was about onerous, unnecessary regulations. And when I evaluate this bill, I evaluated, is it creating more regulations that are going to create more unnecessary paperwork? And I have to say this bill, absolutely yes. Does this bill create the potential for new fees? Absolutely yes. New fees on New Yorkers who are already overburdened with regulations and taxes. Mr. President, I'll be voting no on this legislation. I believe this type of legislation, with complete disregard for private personal information, for increasing taxes or fees, whatever you want to call it, they're both the same, is going to continue to drive people and businesses out of New York State. So, as I said, I'll be voting no.
Senator Amador.
President, will the sponsor rise for or yield for a question?
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President, and just note, thanking the ranking member of our committee for engaging in this in the committee meeting, and I look forward to questions today.
Sponsor yields.
Well, thank you, Senator Kavanaugh. I got a question that, as you were discussing this with Senator Helming, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think I heard you say, if a landlord does not register to the registry, statewide registry, could the landlord then evict a tenant, or would it take away the qualification of eviction?
President, through you, I'm not actually sure this issue was addressed in the prior conversation, but yes, there is a provision in the bill that says if you are attempting to evict a tenant, your papers that you file in court ought to assert that the apartment is properly registered, and if it is not registered, that would prevent you from proceeding with an eviction action. So you would, if you were trying to evict a tenant, first of all, meet this basic requirement of being a landlord in the state.
To you, Mr. President.
If I may clarify, only if the eviction is for non-payment, by the way.
Sponsor yield for a question?
I would yield for additional
sponsor
question,
yields.
Yes.
So, I understand you did mention who is eligible or who would register on a statewide level in this registry. But just, can you give us a more very simplistic explanation? Because I know you're very studied and well-versed and smart. But let's think about, because I look at this, when you talk about two family, I think of my grandmother. And Mr. President, through you, my grandmother who lives in a house or lived in a house in, on Wabash Avenue in the city of Schenectady and in Bellevue section, rented two units there. So what I believe I heard you say, and that's why I want you to explain to me in a very simplistic way, who would need to register on this statewide registry with the Department of State?
Mr. President, the bill would, again, my colleague's assertion that I'm studied as a compliment. And I will say, just to keep it simple, the goal of this bill is to have a complete registry of all rental housing units in the state. So if the sponsor's grandmother were engaging in that business right now in the city of New York, she would already be required to register the two units she is renting, and presumably little or nothing would change as a result of passing this bill. In other parts of the state, if there is no such registry requirement, again, we have great sympathy for people that are renting units to pay for the cost of continuing to live there themselves. Someone who is actually renting units to others would be required to rent those to register those units. If someone has a roommate, or perhaps two roommates, three roommates, or even four roommates, that would not be a situation where they would have to register.
Through you, Mr. President. Sponsor continue to yield.
Does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
So if my grandmother does not register on the statewide registry, which she does not live in the city of New York, but in the city of Schenectady, and there's no requirement to register, and she's not a business, she's just a little old grandma trying to live in a very expensive state of New York, trying to make ends meet. And maybe that little rent money that comes in helps her pay those outrageous taxes on her property. If she doesn't register, because I think what you said in a very long-winded answer, I was hoping for a very short answer, that's why I said please keep it very simple, you're going to make my grandmother register. This bill would make my grandmother register. And so if she doesn't register, what you're saying is there's going to be a fine to anyone who doesn't register. Is that correct?
Mr. President, through you, I look forward to meeting my colleague's grandmother at some point, and we can discuss this further. But yes, if you, and with all due respect to I'm sure my colleague's grandmother, who I'm sure is wonderful, if you are renting apartments to other people, you are in a business. You're in the business of being a landlord, and you are renting apartments to people. And in that circumstance, there are a variety of requirements that already adhere to your decision to do that. And we are adding one additional one, and that is a requirement that they be registered. And if you fail to register, yes, it would be a $25 fine per unit for failing or choosing not to register.
Thank you, Mr. President. Sponsor,
does the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields.
For clarification, Senator Kavanaugh, would the landlord as an entity, one, have to register one time in the state registry, as well as if the local municipality required it, like for instance in New York City, that would be two times? Or would the registry require the entity plus each unit that they rent?
There were two questions there. I will attempt to keep this short. The first question is, would you be required, as I understood it, would you be required to register with a local registry? And the answer is yes, if in spite of our passage of this bill and in spite of the many mechanisms of this bill that are intended to have that local registry count as this registration, if the locality chose to continue in spite of that to have a separate local requirement that you register, the locality would not be preempted from doing so. But it is our expectation that the localities, and we think there are a handful in the state that have registries now, would conform their registries to this, and landlords in those jurisdictions would register only once in that circumstance. And the second question is, basically, you are required to register as a landlord, and you would register in the circumstance we're talking about. A owner-occupied unit with two apartments would register themselves as a landlord, and they would specify that they have two units, and they would meet the requirements of the law with respect to those two units.
Through you, Mr. President.
The sponsor yields.
Yes, Mr.
Sponsor yields.
So then would the fine be imposed upon the entity and the two units that are not registered now if they fail to register, or if a landlord had multiple, hundreds of units, would the fine be the entity of $25 plus 100 units that weren't registered, which would then be multiplied by 25, which is now we're talking about big money in fines. What is the correct answer to the fine?
So the obligation goes to the landlord. Apartments don't have an obligation to register themselves. So the landlord would be required to register, and if you failed to register a rental building, it would be $25 per unit in the covered dwelling. So a landlord that has another building across town that they're properly registered for, that would not affect the penalty for not registering this building. But if this is a two-unit building, it would be $25 times the two units, or $50. And if it's a 10-unit building, it would be 25 times 10, and it would be $250.
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes, Mr. President.
Sponsor yields?
Think of a lot of the small business owners that are out there who do have income properties and who are landlords. And they may have multiple projects or multiple rental locations. So, Senator Kavanaugh, through you, Mr. President, would the landlord be required to register the entity, the business name, the LLC or whatever it may be, sole proprietorship, whatever his corporate or her corporate structure is, as well as each of the locations that the dwelling units are at?
In this line of questioning, Mr. President, but yes, if you are a landlord in the state, you are required to register your rental property through this thing, and the requirement is that each unit be registered, that you register and specify the unit. So if you're renting a 100-unit building, you specify the 100 units in that building. If you're renting a 1-unit building, you specify the 1 unit. And if there's an LLC that I have a beneficial ownership in that owns a building, and another LLC that I have a beneficial ownership in that owns a building, and that the LLC is technically the landlord, each of those LLCs would have the obligation of registering, and they would also have to specify that I'm the person that owns the thing.
Through you, on the bill, Mr. President.
Senator Amador, on the bill.
Thank you, Senator Kavanaugh, I know you and I have had numerous conversations about this and other bills that were on the agenda or the calendar today. And, you know, Senator Helming, I think, hit the ball out of the park when she talked about the word onerous. And there's no question. And I know every single member in this chamber understands this. And I know the reason why, because we all say it in the district that we serve. Why we go to Albany to fight for and to stand up for the rights of our constituents and individuals, and to bring about some sensibility, and to bring about affordability, and to bring about a sense of well-being and a quality of life for all New Yorkers. We all talk about that. We all got elected based on those principles. And we all sit here and we all fight and we all say, yeah, we need to do this and we need to change that, and we got a budget coming up, and you know, before you know it, it's going to pass, and what's the effect going to be? Hopefully more good than bad. But unfortunately, this particular bill adds and compounds to the pain and suffering that our small businesses or even the grandparents face in the state of New York. And for full disclosure, Senator Kavanaugh, unfortunately, you can't speak to my grandmother anymore, who had the apartment because she is now deceased. But I used that as an analogy, really, because there's so many of us here who have loved ones or family members or friends, and their parents or their grandparents who are in the same boat. And they came to this country, they work hard, and they may live in a two-story or a two-family or a three-family home, and in order to make ends meet, they rent it out because their kids moved on and they're old and they have the vacancies. This body now is requiring big government to get the information to very small, now small business owners or individuals who are just leasing out 2 apartments in their home to make ends meet, as if they were a large developer that had hundreds or thousands of units in the state of New York. And if they don't do so, we're going to fine you, penalize you. This is not making New York more affordable. This is not even bringing a quality of life to New Yorkers. This is about more taxes or more fees and more penalties that will be imposed upon New Yorkers. I don't even see how this is going to change the quality of a landlord who's a bad landlord and doing the wrong things and not making the necessary improvements in the dwelling units as they should and invest their money in making a habitable dwelling space safe and warm and cool and clean. This does nothing about truly changing the quality of living conditions, but going after what? More taxes, more revenue, more fines and fees? This is not the narrative that this House should be sending out. Not in this day and age. Not when we got people leaving the state of New York, not by the thousands, but by the tens of thousands, because of onerous, ridiculous, overregulation legislation that this is, because it will not change the quality of life for any New Yorker. We think that a registry is going to fix. You know, we've proposed registries. Senator Tedisco's probably proposed the most registries of anyone here in the chamber. And he proposes those because of the quality of life of the circumstance or situation. Sex offenders, yeah, we should find out who they are, put them on a registry. Animal abusers, yeah, we should do that. But there's a lot of law-abiding, good landlords who've never broken the law, who are tax-paying citizens or businesses in the state of New York, who already apply and abide by. If there's a registry in a local municipality in that jurisdiction, then they sign up. Why do we need a statewide if we already have a local? It's not necessary. Now businesses will have to, or individuals will have to, register twice if required. And it's double the fine, or three times if required. Triple the fines. Doesn't change a single thing about bringing affordability and sensibility to the state of New York. And because of that, Mr. President, I think this bill should hopefully get pulled and worked on in a way that brings about affordability and a quality of life for all New Yorkers. I'll be voting in the negative.
Are there any other senators wishing to be heard? Seeing and hearing none, debate is closed. The secretary will ring the bell. Read the last section.
This act shall take effect immediately.
Call the roll.
Addabbo, Flanagan, Giannaris, Krueger, Stewart, Cousins, Thomas.
Senator Robach to explain his vote.
Yes, Mr. President. Very briefly, I don't even know. I didn't want to take up more time, but Senator Kavanaugh never really even indicated who wants this bill or what the need of it for it. It's very duplicitous at best. There's no reason for it. It seems to me very much that this is bad for the business and it's going to be bad for the tenants. I think we can all understand now when you add costs, whether they're needed or unneeded, and I think in this one they're unneeded, you're just going to pass that on to the people who are looking for a place to stay as affordable as possible. And while it may only be a couple $100 over several years, everywhere I go in my district, people keep saying, do what you can to reduce unnecessary red tape and cost to us. And many of them do not believe we're gonna do that, certainly in upstate New York, and they are voting with their feet. So this may seem funny to some people, or maybe only a couple $100 is a little bit of money in New York City and downstate New York, where we believe in upstate New York, what we're hearing for the people we represent, if you can hear it, is it's kind of time to draw the line in the sand and say, unless this is absolutely necessary, there is a purpose, let's not add any more cost, let's not add any more red tape. And if it works in New York City, God bless you, we already have a local registry, there's just no reason, there really is no reason to have a duplicate statewide registry unless you want to milk these people more and pass more money onto the people who are renting. I firmly cast my vote in the negative, and I hope for the remainder of the session we'll start to take a little bit more attitude rather than laugh about it or cavalierly add to adding costs and things like this without a very good reason. So I vehemently oppose this legislation. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator Robach to be recorded in the negative. Senator Little to explain her vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Just to explain my vote, I really am not aware of any of the towns in my six counties that have a rental registry. I know if you have a larger business, a rental business, you get a DBA, you go and do that, so you are a designated business. I know I have a lot of second homes who rent for a few months at a time. Not always, sometimes it's just a friendly rental. They would have to register their home on a statewide registry. I know that many of my communities are, because of Airbnb and VRBO and all, are asking people who are putting their home on that place for rental that they have to have a license and certain things to qualify for. But I just think it's very, very onerous. I know a guy who has like about 1,500 apartments, $2,500 an apartment every year. It's a money grab, really, because they're not getting anything back for it. And my biggest concern is that if they have a code violation, it goes on the registry. My question is, when does it come off the registry? And we know that many times, even on restaurants, if you go and look it up on the Department of Health, they'll have a health violation that's like a year old. And you know that that place has had to correct it, and they, if you ask, you'll find out it did. So I think there's way too much going on with this bill, and I vote no.
Senator Little to be recorded in the negative. Senator Skoufis to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I first want to commend my colleague, Senator Kavanaugh, for this bill, and make it clear that the $25 that's been bandied around a little bit during this debate, that is not a fee, that is not a tax, that's not a cost. That's what's charged if you fail to register the unit. So, you know, to suggest that you know, this is some kind of money grab, this is the penalty associated with failing to register under this bill. And as far as its value, look, you know, outside of New York City, there are a few, but most of the rest of the state does not have a registry like this. There's going to be basically no duplication. In fact, in the bill that's been amended, if there is a local registry that seeks to make public the same information that this registry will make public, you don't have to register in each of the two registries. And so I want to commend my colleague on a very thoughtful bill and also take this opportunity to thank him, the Housing Committee, the IGO Committee, and in particular, two folks on my team, Sarah DiBernardo and Michael Mazzarello, who, as Senator Kavanaugh noted, spent an exhaustive 5 months looking into an issue that is, for many people, an esoteric issue, not something that a lot of people in the legislature pay much attention to, but code enforcement is a nuts and bolts issue that affects every community in the state and pertains to a lot of folks' safety and well-being throughout New York. And so I want to thank the Majority Leader for her support of this effort and my colleagues for supporting this package.
Senator Skoufis to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Lanza to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. Explain my vote. Actually, you ought to read the legislation. It does call for a registration fee. We don't know where it's going to begin. It'll start as $50, and we know how things work around here. In 5 years, it'll be $250. So there is a fee. There is a cost. And by the way, Senator Robach asked the question, who is the constituent here that is being served? In other words, it seems to me that this is a solution in search of a problem. We have a similar law in New York City. I can tell you, at least on Staten Island, it doesn't work. It's a nuisance. It doesn't help anything. It doesn't make anything better. This is just nothing more than Big Brother, government intrusion. Senator Robach, the constituent here is the government. And we ought to remember that we're here to serve the people. People make a decision every day in the state of New York. Should I live here? Should I continue to raise my family here? And more I hear from people, certainly in my district, that it's getting harder and harder to answer in the affirmative. Another piece of paper to fill out, another fee, another tax, another fine, none of it making my life better. People go to the mailbox with fear. Is there going to be another bill in the mailbox? And because of this law, this legislation, if it becomes law, there will be another bill in the mailbox. You have a two-family home. You're providing a rental property for someone else. When you open your mailbox, there's going to be another bill. And government is going to be watching. And government is going to intrude into your life. And at the end of the day, serving no good interest. Mr. President, I vote no.
Senator Lanza to be recorded in the negative. Senator Boyle to explain his vote.
Mr. President, to explain my vote quickly, I'd like to associate myself with the remarks of my colleagues. And the big question is, why are we doing this? If the talk is about code enforcement, I got news for you. I live in the town of Islip. We have 325,000 people there. A lot of them are renters and landlords. And you know how many violations they've given out in the month of January, this just passed, because of the new discovery laws? Zero. Not one violation was given out in ISLIP in the month of January. So we're doing a lot of this, and all we're going to do is add a list of landlords and houses that are being rented and cause more problems with code enforcement who are not able to do it, put by violations out there now. I vote in the negative.
Senator Boyle to be recorded in the negative. Senator Jackson to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. My colleagues, I rise in order to speak on this particular bill. And I've listened to the testimony and the discussion and debate on the floor. And I refer back to Senator Kavanaugh when he was responding. And basically, he said that the Investigations and Government Operations Committee investigated this matter. And what they found out that code enforcement officials had difficulties serving notices of violations and orders to comply because landlords do not reside in the community of the property or it's owned by an LLC without a registered agent. Come on. We're talking about accountability in the system. And that's what we need and that's what we want. I say to you that obviously this was taken up by New York City and other municipalities because it's very important. And it should be statewide. And we need accountability at every single level, the local level, the regional level, and the statewide level.
Senator, thank you for holding the fort down and communicating why this bill is important. And let me thank Senator Skoufis and the Investigation Committee for doing a good job in bringing this forward. And that's what brought about this legislation. So I vote aye, Mr. President.
Senator Jackson to be recorded in the affirmative. Senator Kavanaugh to explain his vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to note that it's commonly the practice in this House to begin by asking for an explanation for the bill. My colleague on the other side of the aisle just started asking substantive questions, and I started answering them. I presumably could have done what many other people do, which is make a several-minute speech about the bill before getting to the answer and chose not to do so. And then once the debate was closed, it was noted that the question of why this bill, we're doing this bill, was not asked and not answered. So let me take in a few minutes now the opportunity to speak about that. We had, again, numerous hearings. We heard from numerous localities across the state. The notion that we're focused on New York City and New York City only is simply empty rhetoric. The Senate Housing Committee has had 8 hearings in the past 14 months, and only one of them was in the city of New York. We have had roundtables, we've had hearings to get to the question of how we improve affordability and how we improve housing conditions in this state. We heard from tenants, and we heard from landlords, and we heard from code enforcement officials that it is very difficult to implement the most basic laws that are intended to protect the quality and safety of our housing because they have a great deal of difficulty tracking where the rental housing is, who owns it, and how to get in touch with the beneficial owners. It is very frequently people told us that it is residents of New York City that own this housing, and they own it through corporate entities that make it impossible for localities across the state to enforce their laws, and the rental benefit is going to landlords that live in New York City that are unidentifiable by our localities. We also heard that it is very difficult for localities to create systems like this by themselves. The numerous towns and villages, for each of them to create their own registry, would have been an enormous amount of effort on their part. What we are creating here is a single statewide service that would allow all of our localities and all of our code enforcement officials to have tools necessary to enforce the laws that protect the lives and safety and habitability that New Yorkers have a right to expect in their housing. This is a very important piece of legislation. It will be broadly beneficial to the localities that we've been talking about so much today, and it'll certainly be beneficial for the many, many tenants who are living in horrific conditions that we heard testimony from. And again, many members of both on both sides of the aisle were present for hearings where we heard that last year. This is a big step forward. I appreciate the opportunity to speak about it today. I also will note that the Investigations Committee and Senator Skoufis and his colleagues did extraordinary work during the investigatory phase, but the Housing Committee and my colleagues on that also did participate in those hearings, and Amber Marshall and Nick Rangel and Nadia Grebe and my own counsel, Andra Stanley, have also done great work, and I wanted to acknowledge that as well. Thank you, Mr. President. I vote aye.
Senator Kavanaugh to be recorded in the affirmative. Announce the results.
In relation to calendar 393, those senators recorded in the negative are Senators Akshar, Amador, Borrello, Boyle, Brooks, Felder, Flanagan, Funke, Grom, Griffo, Helming, Jacobs, Jordan, Kaminsky, Lanza, Laval, Little, Martinez, O'Mara, Ort, Ritchie, Robach, Serino, Seward, and Tediscos. Aye, 35, nays, 25.
The bill is passed. Senator Janaris, that completes the reading of the controversial calendar.
Is there any further business at the desk?
There's no further business at the desk.
Move to adjourn until tomorrow, Thursday, February 13th at 11 a.m.
On motion, the Senate stands adjourned until Thursday, February 13th at 11 a.m.